studies have been dedicated to the theme of the migration of fantastic creatures. And that is the case, too, in the domain of art history, as seen in the work of Rudolf Witkowa. As Witkowa showed, there were some fantastic beasts and monstrous races whose existence was credited by many civilizations. But it's difficult to trace their exact routes of migration. In this presentation, I would like to show an example of migration, not of a fantastic beast, but of a monstrous race, namely the Pygmaioi, whose story of battles with cranes reached as far as Japan. To trace that migration route in ancient times is beyond my capacity, but its transmission in the early modern era is traceable. Fairy tales, fables, and legends of diminutive peoples tend to be ubiquitous, and thus legendary tales of the small people also existed in Japan. However, from around 1700, we clearly see an element that derived from Greek mythology, the antagonism between the Pygmaioi and cranes. Pliny recounts the story, citing Aristotle as follows. This tribe, Homer has also recorded as being beset by cranes. It's reported that in springtime, their entire band, mounted on the backs of rams and she-goats and armed with arrows, goes in a body down to the sea and eats the cranes' eggs and chickens, and that this outing occupies 3 months, and that otherwise they could not protect themselves against the flocks of cranes that would grow up, and that their houses are made of mud and feathers and eggshells. Aristotle says that the pygmies live in caves, but in the rest of his statement about them, he agrees with the other authorities. The story was well known as seen on an Etruscan vase representing a battle between a Pygmaios and a crane. The story was transmitted in the Liber Monstrorum, written between the 7th and 8th centuries, and persisted throughout the Middle Ages. This is a fragment of a mosaic floor from Casale Monferrato, in northern Italy, from the 12th century. The scene of the battle is depicted also on maps of the New World. In early modern Japan, even if the story of the antagonism between the Pygmaioi and cranes was certainly not indigenous, diminutive humans often came to be represented while defending themselves from a crane, both in literature and in visual arts. This is an ornament on a Japanese sword, katana, a product of the 18th century. There were two routes of transmission into Japan of the Pygmaioi crane story. First, through Chinese sources. In antiquity, also in China, the land of a people small in stature was believed to exist. Dong Fanshao, a Han Dynasty scholar official, state that there was a land of small people which was called the country of cranes. In Shen Yijin, his book on wonders and marvels, the story tells that of the Western Sea of China, there lived people 7 inches tall. They lived 300 years. The only thing that they were afraid of were cranes that swallowed them. They continued, however, to live in the stomach of the crane. Furthermore, they move 100,000 miles a day. Taipeng Guanji, compiled in the late 10th century, includes a similar story in the section of barbarians. Whether this story derives from a Western classical source, or whether they share the same source, or whether they were generated independently is not known. The much later Chinese encyclopedia, Sankai Tuhui, contains an entry of an ethnic group of short people and explains that they proceed in groups for fear of cranes, though the illustration does not include any cranes. The Wakan Sansai Zue, an illustrated Sino-Japanese encyclopedia based on Sankai Tuhui, completed in 1712, repeats the story, and here the illustration shows a crane flying over some short peoples. A beautifully illustrated manuscript of a Ikonku Monogatari based on Sankai Tuhui seems to be the first to depict short people in a group with a crane. Second route, the notion of the land of small people transmitted by Christian missionaries. Starting in the 16th century, information on fabulous races taken to be authentic in European antiquity was transmitted by Christian missionaries sent to Asian countries. In 1590, the Japanese Tensho embassy sent to the Pope also took back Olterius' world map, a globe, and Civitatis Orbis Terrarum, edited by Brown and engraved by Hohenberg in 1572. They were copied onto beautiful byobu, namely folding screens, bearing a world map with Japan at the center, and or maps of historical cities of the world. Some of byobu bear representations of various ethnic groups depicted around the world map. Oh, sorry. This part, this part. These byobu are said to have been used for propagation of Catholic teaching, but were probably not seen by wide public. A European world map, which had a greater influence in Japan, was that imported through China, namely that of Matteo Ricci. His map, Kunyu Wango o Kwantu, made in 1602, bears some information about monstrous races, such as land of women, a land of cannibals, land of dogs, namely Cynocephaloi, and so on. We see, moreover, the legend of the land of short people in Northern Europe at the eastmost, at the conjunction of Scandinavia with the rest of the continent, which reads as follows. Land of short people, both men and women, are about 1 foot tall. At the age of 5, they have children, and at 8 years, they are already old. Cranes always try to eat them, and they flee into caves. Every year during the 3 months of summer, they go out and break cranes' eggs. They were said to ride on sheep. Giulio Aleni and other missionaries, too, produced world maps based on Matteo Ricci's. Areni's map was made in 1622. Under the national isolation policy of the Tokugawa shogunate, Christian missionaries in Japan were expelled in 1614, and the introduction of Western learning was prohibited. But some scholars, such as Nishikawa Joken, could study Areni's work when he published a geographic encyclopedia, Kai Itsushoko, in 1702. Here is the land of short people. In addition to those, a world map paired with images of world ethnic groups started its print run in Nagasaki in 1645. Those prints also included a people short of stature and one of tall stature. Oh, excuse me. Small people and tall people. Though the iconography of short and tall peoples in these prints derived from Chinese sources, How did the land of Pygmalion came to end up in Northern Europe in Rich's map? The Pygmalion habitat continued to change. In the Iliad, they are in the southern shores on Oceanus, to which cranes migrated in winter. For Ctesias, the Pygmalion were one of the Indian tribes. Pliny stated that the Pygmalion live in a mountainous area of India. In some medieval Mappa Mundi, the Pygmalion were placed in the southern margin of the world in a row with other monstrous races, and in the Hellebore map, monstrous races were arranged all around the edge of the world. Odorico of Pordenone locates Pygmalion-like people near Nanjing in Cathay, China. The habitat of fantastic beasts and monstrous races were prevalently in Africa and the Orient, particularly in India. However, the northmost area too was another marginal place from the time of antiquity. And in the 11th century, Adam of Bremen reports some monstrous people in Scandinavia. He says that the Amazones, Kinocephaloi, Cyclopes, and Himantopodes were to be found in Denmark. At the northmost shore of Norway, he locates the Skrytfingi, who used magic. Their women had beards. When they spoke, they were said to gnash their teeth rather than to utter words. Then beyond the Baltic Sea and the Great Sea, Adam reports islands and lands with a Husi people with pale green faces, Kinocephaloi and Amazones, etc. And Olaus Magnus, Historia de Gentibus Septentrionalibus, written in 1555, reports people fighting with cranes in Greenland, citing Pliny's statement about the Pygmalion. Rich's transportation of Pygmalion into northern areas may have been influenced by such writings. The more exploration of unknown parts of the world proceeded, the more the confines of the terra incognita advanced, and consequently, the more the habitat of fabulous beasts and monstrous races retreated. Now, let us see where the territory of short people in Japan was believed to exist. Coincidentally, in the early modern era, they too were believed to live near Ezo, nowadays Hokkaido, in northern Japan. Japan at that time was expanding its territory northward and seeking to integrate the islands near Ezo, especially after the revolt of Shakushain, the chieftain of the Ainu, the indigenous people of Ezo, between 1669 and 1672. Another reason for which the Edo shogunate came to be interested in that area was the presence of the Russia, who had already depicted the islands of northern Japan in their map by the end of the 17th century. In the 18th century, Japan started to be more conscious of the Russian menace and began their effort to integrate Ezo into Japan. Previously, Edo had been a northern frontier area, which was not very well recognized. And information on Ezo was confusing also in the geographic sphere. The first published Japanese map, Shogaisho, does not depict Hokkaido Island. It's, there's nothing here. But with the Edo shogunate map made in an effort to control the north frontier, the island of Ezo came to be represented in maps produced in Japan. One Japanese map, Shinzen Dainihon Zukan, compiled in the late 17th century, included Ezo and a small islands near it with the caption, "The land of people of short stature." Kemper's Engelbert Kempfer's map of Japan based on it, also included an island of short people near Ezo with the legend Kubitusima or Pygmalion Inns. So this part is written, depicted here. And that is Kubitusima or Pygmalion Island. There used to be a fairy tale that located an island of short people near Ezo. It is included in Otogizoshi, which was compiled during Muromachi area. The fabulous story recounts that Minamoto no Yoshitsune, the warrior hero, was sent to defeat the Oni, which are ogres, who inhabited Ezo Island. And before reaching there, he toured near islands inhabited by fabulous races, included an island of short people, an island inhabited only by women, and so on. Ezo, a geographical border area, was considered to confine another world. This territory, which remained terra incognita in many senses, was suitable for fabulous creatures to inhabit, just as maps of the New World made in the Age of Discovery were also filled with classical monsters and fantastic beasts, along with newly discovered creatures. We observe here that the entry for the short people is found in book 14 entitled Barbarian People in Wakan Sansai Zue, in which monstrous people similar to Kinokephaloi or Amazones are gathered along with some genuine ethnic groups existed in reality, such as Cambodians, the inhabitant of Luzon and the kingdom of Champa. The Ainu, here called Ezo, on the other hand, are included in book 13, titled Fallen Peoples, in company with Ryukyuans, Mongolians, and Koreans, it is peoples of near territories. According to Terashima Ryoan, the author of Wakan Sansai Zue, what distinguishes a fallen people from barbarian people is the fact that the latter do not understand Chinese characters and do not use chopsticks. However, the Ainu were considered somehow a very remote race, as shown in a report of them, which stated that two of three Ainu tribes hardly spoke a comprehensive language. We may compare this report with that of Adam of Bremen on the Sklitofingi in Norway, a group hardly utters words. Indeed, Ezo was Ogre Island in the fairy tale. To the notion of an island of short people in northern Japan near Ezo, the story of Pygmalion and the crane was attached. In many writings from the 17th century, the story was reported, and many visual representations were made with small people walking together to protect themselves from attacks by cranes. Considering the migration of some fantastic beasts in Europe, we may find some similar phenomena. After Adam of Bremen, other geographical works about northern countries were compiled. Ireland came to be considered a place of many miracles, as we see in Gerald of Wales' late 12th century ethnographic work, Topographia Hiberniae, when Odorico Pordenone reported on a melon which produced a small lamb near the Caspian Mountains in Tartary. He emphasized its reliability with the example of trees that produced birds in Ireland. Ireland was the most remote island of the West, according to Gerald, and one of the places that spawned wonders. Men tend to locate fantastic beasts and monstrous races in geographic border areas at the very limit of knowledge. However, the human capacity to recognize something new and wondrous in what was already known was equally evident. Ideas of legendary and fabulous beasts and monstrous peoples seem to be easily grafted onto some already existing similar myths, legends, and tales. New information is grafted onto indigenous tales, and as new information and iconography, as in the case of the legendary Japanese short people, who came to be frequently depicted in association with cranes. Thank you very much.